hormone is a one of the hormone which is produced by hypothalamus, right? Is it audible? Hello.
Yes, sir.
So this production is production of LH is regulated by another hormone. We call it as a GnRH. It's a gonadotropic releasing hormone, and this hormone is released where is released by hypothalamus, right? So hypothalamus secretes GnRH, and GnRH acts on the pituitary glands, and pituitary gland produces LH. Okay, this is the production process of LH, and this acts differently in male and female. So LH, which is the hormone which is synthesized in both in male and female, okay, but the work is different in male and the female, right? In male, it affects the testes, so this is the target for this LH hormone in male, whereas in female, it stimulates the Leydig cells to produce. Yes, it's male. Basically, in the male, we are talking about male stimulates the Leydig cells. Okay, so Leydig cell is a specialized cells which produces testosterone in the male, right? And in women, it affects ovaries, right? And in the ovaries, what happens? It triggers ovulation process, and also the development of corpus luteum to produce estrogen. So in response to the LH in female, the ovulation is triggered, okay? And the second thing is that there is a development of corpus luteum, okay, which further produces estrogen hormone, right? So this is the effect of LH hormone in the male and the female, which is a different type of effect. So did you understand from here? What is the action of the LH hormone in male and female? In male, it affects testes. In female, it affects ovaries. And in male, basically, one of the cell is a Leydig cell, which produces testosterone in response to LH. Whereas in female, the ovulation process is triggered, okay, in the ovaries. And also the corpus luteum, the follicular cells is changed to corpus luteum, and which further produces estrogen hormone. Okay, LH play a role in puberty, menstruation, and fertility. So this is a very, very important role in the, the female, that it has a very important role in the puberty, and then menstruation process, as well as the fertility of the female. Another general information, let's know about the structure of the LH hormone, that how it looks like. It's a chemically, it's a glycoprotein hormone, means there is a protein part as well as a carbohydrate moieties attached to the protein, and because of that we say it's a glycoprotein hormone. And if you see the structure, we will see that there are two subunits, okay, one is alpha subunits and another is a beta subunits. So the structure has a similar to, somehow we can see alpha is basically, alpha subunit is similar to TSH, FSH, and SCG, chorionic gonadotropin hormone. Okay, so the alpha, it has the two subunits that we have studied. One is alpha and another is beta. So alpha is similar to TSH, FSH, and SCG, whereas the beta is very, very specialized and unique to LH. In alpha subunit has 89 amino acid residues, right? And beta subunit has 129 amino acid residues. So there are 89 amino acids in alpha subunit, and there are 129 amino acid in the beta subunits. Okay, so we have understand. And after that, if the structure, which is called as a glycoprotein structure, so 15 to 30% of the total content is carbohydrate. Okay, and the remaining is a protein, which is has a two subunits, alpha and beta, right? So 15 to 30% of the content is carbohydrate in the glycoprotein hormone. Now coming to the clinical significance, that why we do this test, why this test is very, very important. So LH measurement helps in the diagnosis of infertility in male or female. Infertility is something where the person is unable to conceive, unable to make a child. Okay, so this test is done along with FSH. So when we do LH, we should do FSH together. Okay. Increased serum LH is observed when there is a hypogonadism, when there is a primary ovarian failure, when there is a polycystic ovary disease, or primary testicular failure, or flying filter syndrome. So these are the different conditions where LH hormone is, you know, supposed to increase in the blood. Whereas a decreased level of, you know, serum LH is on basically when there is a dysfunction of pituitary or hypothalamus. So because the pituitary is produced in the, LH is produced in the pituitary gland and also regulated by hypothalamus. So if the production, if it is decreases, it means that there is effect of, or there is a dysfunction of pituitary gland, okay? So dysfunction of pituitary gland or hypothalamus leads to decreased level of serum LH in the, okay? And the increased levels are observed in this particular specific condition. What are the symptoms? Failure to conceive, like infertility. This is, these are the infertility symptoms, okay, related to LH. Failure to conceive, irregular menstruation, okay, no periods at all. So these are the, you know, symptoms related to the female. Low testosterone level in man. So this is the symptoms related to the male, that always the testosterone levels are low, and the low sex drive in the man. So the sex drive of the man becomes lower. There is no interest in doing no sexual activities, and there is low muscle mass in man. Okay, so this is what the muscle mass also, you know, is concerned with the level of LH. So man who has a low level of LH, so they have a low muscle mass actually. Working principle, that if you talk about the principle that how it works, so here we have given samples containing LH. So here we have a serum sample that has LH to be determined. Now we have anti-LH HRP conjugate, which are as a reagent. Which, what is the meaning of this anti-LH HRP? Here the one antibodies which are against luteinizing hormone. So it is bound to the HRP antibody enzyme. HRP is a horse radix peroxidase. So enzyme level antibodies is known as, sorry? Is there any? Yes, any question?
No, sir.
Okay, so these are the given, okay? So we have a sample that required LH to be determined. Second is the anti-LH HRP conjugate, which means antibodies labeled with the enzyme, okay, HRP enzyme. And the third we require is a, in a, we have been given is a Wells, okay, which is coated with the anti-LH. Okay, so antibody coated Wells are also provided. Okay, so we have two antibodies. One is antibodies coated to the Wells, and another antibodies which are enzyme level. Okay, so these two antibodies have been given. Okay, and then we can be able to determine the level of LH in the sample. So this is the principle. LH in the sample forms a sandwich between the two specific antibodies. So because this is a sandwich method of ELISA, so two antibodies, one is coated with the Wells, and other antibodies are conjugate antibodies. So the two antibodies, you know, sandwich the LH present in the sample. Yeah, I got a some notification. Let me check once again. Yeah, Ajaz Ahmed is willing to join. Welcome to Ajaz. Okay, Priya. Priya has given the masses. T3, T4, TSH. Okay, three ho gaya hai. So we are learning the fourth experiment today, right? So coming to the principle, Azaz, you can get help from your classmate. We have learned. This is the fourth experiment we are learning, and this is the. The experiment name is luteinizing hormone LH test, and the principle is based on the sandwich ELISA, where two antibodies sandwich the LH present in the sample. Now, what happens? The second is when the unbound LH and HRP conjugates are washed off. So when the antibodies are sandwiched with the LH, okay. So when we add the sample, so sample LH will be sandwiched between the two specific antibodies. And after that, unbound and HRP conjugate, which are free and enzyme bound antibodies, then it should be washed off during the washing procedure. here upon the addition of substrate, the color is developed. So we can add the substrate so that the substrate will act with the HRP. Okay, this HRP, HRP which is bound with antibody. So HRP can react with the substrate and give the color. Upon the addition, now the intensity of color is proportional to the concentration of LS in the sample. So here the sandwich ELISA, what happens, the, if there is a more color development, okay, so the, it's proportional to the concentration of LH. Okay, so more color, more concentration of LH in the sample. And finally, a standard curve is prepared relating to color intensity to the concentration of LH. So here, the color versus concentration, a graph is plotted. And then after that, we can be able to determine the level of, you know, LH in the unknown sample. Okay. What we require here? We require microwells coated with anti-alpha LH, anti-LH antibodies. Then here we require LH standard. So here 7 vials of standards is provided. It's also known as calibrators. And the concentration is given here 0, 5, 15, 50, 100, and 200. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, there are only 6. So there are 7 standards are provided actually. Okay, I think one is missing somewhere. 150 is missing. Okay, so here the unit of the standard is micro international unit per ml. Okay, what is the in unit? It's a micro international unit per ml. And now the LH conjugate reagent, which is the enzyme labeled antibody. Okay, so enzyme is basically HRP, which means horse radish peroxidase, right? So anti LH. So here we can see this, in there are two enzymes we are using here. So one enzyme which is coated to the wells are the, against the alpha subunits of the LH, whereas the conjugate conjugate means enzyme labeled antibody that we are using here. So this enzyme, this antibody is against the beta subunits of the LH. So this this recognize, this binds alpha subunits of LH, and this antibody binds the beta subunits of the LH. Okay, so this is why we have used the two antibodies, okay, which binds specific subunits of the LH that we study in the structure. We have a two subunits in the LH structure. One is alpha subunits and another is the beta subunits. So alpha subunits binds is coated to the alpha this alpha antibody, okay. Is coated to the microwells, which only binds to the alpha subunits of the LH, but it's a beta subunits will be bind by this anti-beta LH, which is conjugated or coated with the enzyme, which is known as HRP, horse radish peroxidase. Now, the fourth reagent are one is a substrate. This is a TMB substrate, tetramethyl benzidine, which also contain hydrogen peroxide. And then we need to have required a stock solution with the one normal HCl, 20x wash concentrate. So this is the concentrated wash solution. We need to convert 20x into 1x. So by dilution, we can do, we can convert, we can make 1:20 dilution. Okay, so one part we can take this, and another part we can take normal saline. So in such way also we can make it, or whatever we have also studied. So we the dilution process by C1V1 C2V2, in that way also we can do the dilution. Now materials required but not provided here, right? Here distilled water is not provided, but we require this precision pipette, that is known as auto pipette or micro pipette. We require tips, disposable pipette tips. We require ELISA reader, which is capable of reading absorbance at 450 nanometer. And we need a paper towel, absorbent paper towel. That is required for soaking the, this is required during washing process. When we wash the wells, so this is required. And we require graph paper where we can plot the standard curve graph between the absorbance and concentration, right? So absorbance versus concentration graph can be plotted using the graph paper. And we require timer, of course, because the incubation is required. Okay. Now coming to the requirements here, we have ELISA reader. Okay. we have a micropipette, we have a microplate, you know, this is the microplate with the different wells, tips, tip box. These are the basic requirements that we have already mentioned. So this is the peaks. This is what where the microplate can be placed over here, and we can program this my ELISA reader, and then we can, you know, according to the you know, operating procedure, we can take the reading of each and every wells, right? Are you able to hear my voice? And one of you just give me the feedback. Is my voice audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So this is the microplate with the different wells. Okay, there are A, B, C, D, E, F, and then, you know, 8 wells at the row side, and the 12 wells, you know, at the column side. Okay, so these are the columns and these are the rows. 12 at the 96 wells can be accommodated. So a specimen collection and preparation. How can we collect the specimen? What preparation is required? So we require serum. Serum can be used as a sample in the assay, and do not use hemolytic, ectopteric, and lipemic specimen. So you should take care of this. So not to take the hemolytic or ectopteric or lipemic specimen. Do you know what is hemolytic? When the blood is hemolyzed, when the red cells are hemolyzed. What is ectopteric? Where you know, there is a high level of bilirubin in the sample. Okay, so serum become dark yellow color. Lipemic, where there is a white color, whitish milky color serum because of a increased amount of lipid in the blood. Please note, samples containing sodium azide should not be used in the assay. So this is what you need to note this, because sodium azide inhibit HRP enzyme activities. Here one of the antibodies is coated with the HRP, so this enzyme activity can be inhibited, right? We have also studied the enzyme inhibition process. There, if the enzyme is inhibited, what will happen? So enzyme will not catalyze the reaction. So this is what we should not take a sample that has been added with the sodium azide. Specimen can be stored for up to 5 days at 2 degrees Celsius, 2 to 8 degrees Celsius, or up to 1 month at -20 degrees Celsius. So this is what the instruction is given, that we can store the sample up to 5 days or up to 1 month as per our requirement. Now, dilution of 20x was buffered. So this is the instruction given that we can prepare by 1x buffered solution from 20x, thus by adding the content of 25 ml of this bottle, which like 20x is present in 25 ml of one bottle. Okay, and this all the entire content can be mixed with the 475 ml of this water. This, okay, so here this is the ratio of 1:20, and here we'll get a 1x wash solution buffer. Store at room temperature. This wash buffer can be, the working wash buffer can be stored at one room temperature. Now coming to the procedure, that with the general remarks, that this is very, very important, you need to understand. Bring all reagents and specimen to room temperature before use. So this is a pre-procedure preparation, we can say. So all the reagents or specimen that we have, we need to bring at the room temperature, and then all reagent must be mixed without foaming. So there should not be the foam formation when we mix the reagents. All steps should be completed without interruption. So once we start the process, there should not be any interruption. Okay, so there should not be any delay. Okay, all steps should be completed subsequently. Always use new disposable tips for each standard, control, or sample. So here we need to take different tips, different micropipette tips for different samples, like different standard, strength, control. Okay, so tips should be changed time to time. So this is how we can take. We can, these are the multi-channel pipette. This is single channel pipette. So we can. This is what multi-channel pipette is. Recommended that it will avoid the delay in the, you know, pipetting process, mixing process. Procedure now, coming to the procedure, what can we do? Like first of all, place the desired number of microwells in the holder. So whatever the holder we have, in the holder we have to put the microwells as per our requirement. And then we can pipette 50 microliters of standard, control, and specimen into the designated wells. So So take this all, ingredients, 50 microliter of standard, 50 microliter control, and 50 microliter of specimens in the designated wells. The well that we have labeled with the standard, the wells that we have labeled with the control, and the wells that we have labeled with the specimen. So in that particular specific wells, we can add this, ingredients. 800 microliter of ready-to-use conjugate reagents to all wells. So we can add, the enzyme level antibody to all the wells. Miss Nandu. There is a voice coming from your background.
Sir,
the army
on the
Khabar. Okay, sir, Nandu, chup ho jaa, tum fail do na.
Okay. So what we are learning is, are you able to see the screen? Can you see the screen, Krishnan?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So okay, mute yourself now. Let's listen to the procedure. We have to take the different number of microwells as per the requirement, and we have to put the microwells into the holder, and we need to label it out. Okay, we need to label. And after that, we can pip it 50 microliter of the, this standard control, and then what we say specimen into the, the designated wells, the level wells, okay? And then after that, 800 microliter of ready to use conjugate reagent to all wells. What is the conjugate reagent? What it mean? It is an antibody which is labeled with the enzyme, okay? So enzyme level antibody can be added to all the wells. How much we require? It's 100 microliter. After that, we need to sit for 10 to 30 seconds. This is the mixing process. This is very, very important, because until we do the mixing, there will be no any, binding process. So here we need to, add this one, because this antibody level in, in the enzyme are going to bind with the standard, are going to bind with the control, are going to bind with the specimen. So this is very, very important step. Next. Cover the plate and incubate for 45 minutes. So after this addition of the enzyme level antibodies, we need to cover it. Okay, and you can incubate for the period of 45 minutes at the room temperature, right? And then after that, after the incubation, we should remove the liquid from the wells. Just tap it out, and we can remove this liquid from the wells. Next, we need to do is the washing process. So wash the well 3 times. With 1x wash buffer. So we just take the wash buffer in each wells, and then just shake it out and then discard it. Again, do the process 2 times, 3 times, okay? And and finally, we need to blot on absorbance, absorbent paper towel. So the paper towel that we require, so this is here, it is required for blotting, okay? And then 800 microliter of TMB substrate to all wells. So now after addition, after washing process, we need to add the TMB substrate, 100 microliter to all the wells. Where the substrate is present, now the enzyme labeled antibody react with the TMB substrate. What is supposed to get? So here we need to do incubation first in dark, okay, because the TMB is light sensitive. So to incubate in dark for 20 minutes, okay, at room temperature, and during this incubation period, the enzyme and substrate reaction takes place. And after that, 800 microliter stock solution to all wells, which stop the enzymatic reactions. So shake the plate gently to mix the solution. Ensure that all of the blue color changes completely to yellow color. So here, after incubation, we will see that there is change in the blue color. And after addition of stock solution, we will see that the blue color will change to yellow color. Okay. Now we'll do the final step, that is a reading process. So we need to read the absorbance at 450 nanometer using ELISA reader, and this should be done within 15 minutes. Okay, reading should be done within the 15 minutes, right? to error analysis, repeating of all the standard sample and control should be completed within 3 minutes. So this is very, very crucial stage in the pipetting process, in the procedure, that all the pipetting should be done within 3 minutes of the time. And it is recommended that the wells be read within 15 minutes. And when like at the last step, like when we go for the, when we are ready with the, you know, reading process, so it should be, the absorbance should be taken between, within the 15 minutes, okay, after the addition of stop solution. So here is a standard curve. The standard curve is constructed as follows. Check LS standard value on each standard vial. Okay, there is a 7 vials are provided, and the standard value is given on the each and every standard vial. And we need to construct the center curve, like plot the absorbance value in vertical axis, y axis, and concentration value in vertical axis, that is known as x axis. So here x axis in the graph we can plot concentration, and on y axis we can plot the absorbance. So absorbance we already have taken through the ELISA reader. Now we can check the respective concentration of each absorbance, and we can draw the best curve through the points, and we will read the absorbance for control as well as also for the unknown sample with the help of the curve. Okay, we can record the value for each control or unknown sample. Any diluted sample must be further corrected by the appropriate dilution factor. Here, if you have diluted any sample, then what will happen? At the last, you need to multiply with the dilution factor. Okay, so this is also required. So this is what we can see, that from A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, there are 8 wells. Okay, and there are 12, 8 wells can be adjusted in the 12 columns of the holder. Okay, and we can see the different. Here, this is the LH, and 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There are 6, vials are given, right? And this concentration, this is 0. This is concentration 5, 15, 50, 100, 200. These are the concentration given in milli, in micro, international per ml. And now, actually, the absorbance at 450 nanometer, that's, let's say, we have got 0.043. We have got this much absorbance. So these are the, you know, specific absorbance which I have mentioned for each standard here. Okay, so starting from 0 standard to 200 standard, we have been provided the absorbance also. Now we can plot the cylindrical curve graph using the standard curve graph by plotting concentration on x-axis and absorbance on y-axis. So this is an example of typical cylindrical curve. Okay, and here we can be able to find out the concentration of unknown sample. Let's say the absorbance of unknown sample we have got at 1.5. So we can draw a line over here, and we can find the concentration over here. Okay, so this is what the graph we have understand. Normal range in male, it's 0.7 to 7.5 micro international per ml. The female, and the values varies at the different phase of the, you know, the menstruation phase, like follicular phase, this is the value, ovulation phase, luteal phase, and this is the menopausal phase of the female. So at the different stage of the life, in female, the LH value is different. Now, if you have any question, please ask me. We have ended the lecture today. Now, coming to the slides, coming to the discussion point, now you can ask the question. Let's discuss the any if you have questions.